When we analyze panel data, the static model assumes that the error terms are IID, independent and identically distributed, over I, the alternatives, N, the individuals, and T, time. But several user-specific, unobserved characteristics are constant over time, and the assumption is not appropriate. This is called serial correlation. In this video, we investigate how to deal with the issue. This is a representation of the static model that we have introduced in the previous video. So we have a choice model for each specific time interval, and they are independent from each other. What is serial correlation? Serial correlation captures the fact that the epsilons here are carrying things which are constant over time. Typically, everything related to the user, to the decision maker. And in this case, the models here cannot be supposed to be independent. So that's what we need to do. We need to relax the assumption that the epsilons are independent across T. We can continue to assume that they are independent across I and N. In any case, we know how to deal with these dimensions. But in the context of panel data, we would like to relax the one across T. And the underlying assumption that we make is that the source of the correlation comes from the fact that they are unobserved factors which are related to the individual and that are persistent over time. How do we do that? Well, we will come back to an idea that we have used several times in the past, which is using error components. And the idea is the following. I will write the epsilon I and T, so the error term associated with I, N, and T, as the sum of an error component which is related to I, N, N, not T, plus the rest, which I denote by epsilon prime. This error component alpha, I, N here, which does not depend on T, is designed to capture what I described before. This is designed to capture all these unobserved factors related to the individual, which are the same across time. It is known in the literature as the agent effect, or sometimes the panel effect, and this is there to capture unobserved heterogeneity. And now, if we have this error component that captures these unobserved factors persistent over time, we can safely assume that the epsilon prime are independent across T. And this is what we will do. If we do so, if we assume that the epsilon primes are independent across T, well, then we can apply the static model as we did in the previous video. And there are two versions of this model. One that we call the model with fixed effects, where we assume that the alpha are unknown parameters to be estimated. And another one that we will call the model with random effects, where we will assume that the alpha are distributed. And I will review the two of them separately. So this is the specification of the utility function. So the utility function, alternative I, individual N, and time T, the deterministic part, the agent effect, and the rest of the error term, epsilon prime. And in this case, alpha I, N is a set of parameters that have to be estimated. Again, we will assume that the epsilon prime now are IID extreme value across I, N, and T. Okay, and again, because we have introduced the agent effect, this assumption is deemed more valid than the one we did before. And we have to assume that these alphas are independent from these error terms. So we obtain a logit model, which is similar to the one that we had before. The only difference is that we have these extra parameters which basically play the role of an alternative specific constant for each individual in the population. And the rest is the same. So when we have the static model with fixed effect, well, because the epsilon primes are supposed to be independent, the probability of the trajectory, again, is the product of the probability of each choice. And when you take the log, you get the sum of the log as before. So everything is the same. Well, but there is a but. In this model, the extra parameters that we have introduced are designed to capture the permanent test heterogeneity. As I said, they are somehow represented an alternative specific constant, so one of them must be normalized to zero. The problem is that if you want to estimate these parameters with precision, you need a lot of observations. And here, because each parameter is related to an individual, well, you cannot just interview more people. What you need is to observe this individual longer and longer. So capital T should increase. And actually, the properties are asymptotic. So the consistent estimation of these parameters assumes that T is going to infinity. But in practice, usually capital T is relatively short. I mean, there are exceptions. Usually you observe people over, I don't know, a handful or maybe hundreds of time periods. But in that case, this asymptotic results do not apply, and it may actually have an effect on the quality of the estimates of the other parameters. So you may actually pollute your model if you don't have enough observation. So this is the case where, yes, we capture this serial correlation, but in practice, you usually don't have enough observation for the model to be consistently estimated and to be practical. So the exceptions are when you have a lot of observation for the same individuals, and modern technology allows to do that. With smartphones in particular, you can log a lot of data for the same individual over a long period of time. In that case, this technique should be appropriate. When the static model with fixed effect cannot be used, we have to rely on the static model with random effect. And here, the idea is to say that, well, instead of trying to estimate a different parameter for each individual, we will simply assume that the parameter is a random variable distributed across the population. So to simplify the notations, I will denote by alpha n the vector that puts together all the alpha I n that we have introduced before. And I will assume that this is a random variable, so this is distributed, and I know the density function. For example, we can assume that alpha n follows a normal distribution of mean zero and variance covariance sigma. Aha, so we have introduced a random parameter in our model. We know what it is. It is a mixture. It's a mixture of logit. Okay? So the static model with random effect happens to be a mixture of static models. Okay, so conditional to alpha, I have a static model, because the epsilon primes are assumed to be independent across time, and then I will have to integrate over alpha. So let's look at what it means. This is the specification of the model, so this is the same specification as for the fixed effect. The only difference is that this alpha I n here is supposed to be distributed, for example, a normal distribution. And again, we assume that alpha n is independent from epsilon prime here. So now we have a conditional choice probability. Conditional to alpha n, we have a logit model, because epsilon prime are ii the extreme value. Now what we need to calculate is the probability of the trajectory for individual n. So we can do that, right? What is the probability of the trajectory conditional to alpha? Well, this is simply the product over T, capital T, of the choice probability conditional to alpha that we have derived in the previous slide, which is the logit model. So this is conditional independence. Conditional to the alpha, the sequence of choice are independent. But of course, we don't know alpha, so we need to integrate out alpha. That's what we do here. The probability of the trajectory that we need for the likelihood function is the integral over alpha of the quantity that we have derived above. Okay, so this is a mixture. We have a random parameter alpha, so we first write the kernel, which is the choice probability conditional to this random parameter. This is a logit model in this case, and then we integrate. For mixture models, we know that the integral cannot be calculated analytically, so we need to rely on simulation to calculate this integral, or at least to approximate it. So what we do is that we approximate this integral by generating these draws from the density function, and the approximation is 1 divided by capital R, which is the number of draws, times the sum over R. So basically we take the average, the empirical mean of the values, and the values are given by the formula that we introduced in the previous slide, so the probability of each choice conditional to the draw. Just a side comment. This formula involves the calculation of a product of several probabilities. So these are small numbers, and when you multiply probabilities by probabilities, the numbers become smaller and smaller, and this may have impact, numerical impact on a computer. You can give it a try on a simple spreadsheet to see the problem. So therefore, there is another way to write the same formula where you can actually decrease the impact of these numerical issues. And you do it like this, so the sum over R, so this is the same. But then you replace the product here, you take the log, because the log of a product will become the sum of a log. But the log is not there, so what we have to do is to calculate the exponential of the log of the product. And I will write pt here. And so the formula becomes the sum over r of the exponential of the sum over t of the log of the probability of I n t given alpha r. Okay, so this is a trick to calculate this quantity. So you first calculate the log of all the probabilities. You make the sum of these logs for all the observations across time, and then you take the exponential. Okay, so the result in exact arithmetic would be exactly the same, but in finite arithmetic on computers, you may actually have a better result in some cases. Some comments about this static model with random effect. Well, you have several parameters to be estimated. You have the betas, which are the parameters from the utility function, but you have also the variance-covariance matrix of the distribution of the alpha of the agent effect. We do maximum likelihood estimation, so this leads to consistent and efficient estimators. Consistent means asymptotically unbiased. Interestingly, if you ignore the correlation, so if you remove this alpha n, as we did in the static model, you can show that the estimates are consistent, but not efficient. So because it's not a true likelihood function, you lose efficiency, but you keep consistency. And here we accounted for serial correlation, therefore we obtain the true likelihood function, which means that the estimates are consistent and efficient. In this video, we have addressed the problem of serial correlation by introducing an error component specification. The error term is defined as the sum of one term that is constant over time and a random variable that is assumed to be independent across time. The term that is constant over time is called the panel effect or the agent effect. The version of the model with fixed effect requires to estimate a great deal of parameters and to have access to a large number of observations for each individual. This is not always possible in practice. Therefore, we have introduced a version of the model with random effects, which complicates the formulation of the log-likelihood function as it involves a mixture specification.